Hello and welcome to video lecture series in political science. Today we are going to discuss chapter 5 titled as Contemporary South Asia from your textbook Contemporary World Politics. Do you know that it is important to know our neighbors? Because peace and stability in a particular country is dependent upon the kind of relationship a particular country has with its neighbors. This chapter will be divided into 6 parts, and in all these 6 parts we will know about neighbors of India or all the countries that together constitute South Asia. This is about South Asia, its politics, its geography, its demography and its social and cultural composition. In this chapter we will discuss about various countries in South Asia, their experience and journey to establish democracy in various countries, their relationship with India and what are the areas of cooperation and conflict between these individual nations vis-a-vis India. Today we'll begin by understanding what is South Asia actually, and also about the South Asian Regional Cooperation, the regional organization called as SAARC, that is the regional organization which came into existence as a consequence of all the South Asian countries coming together. So let's begin. Now what is South Asia, or what is Asia in general? Asia is the largest and most populous continent located primarily in the eastern and northern hemispheres of planet Earth. Asia and Europe are two continents which are not geographically separated, or there is no geographical boundary between the two. The commonly accepted boundary between these two continents, Europe and Asia, is Ural Mountain Range and Ural River. But the boundaries between these two continents are culturally determined. Together, Asia and Europe, the landmass is often called as Eurasia. Now look at this map. This map shows all the major continents in the world. North America and South America can be distinctively seen because they are all surrounded by water bodies on all the four sides. Africa too is surrounded by ocean from all the four sides. However, when we look at Europe and Asia combined, as we discussed, that there is no geographical boundary between the two other than the Ural Mountain Range and the Ural River, which separates the two. And look at the size of Asia. It's too huge, it's most populous and the biggest landmass among all the continents. Now, Asia itself is too vast and diverse. So what we do, we further divide it into different regions or sub-regions. What are these regions? These regions are North Asia, Central Asia, West Asia, South Asia, East Asia and Southeast Asia. These regions are rich in diversity. These regions have multiple languages, ethnicity, religious affiliations, people belonging to different races, people practicing different types of culture, etc. They are so different from each other that it would be difficult to categorize all of them under few categories. Now let us look at this map and identify various regions within Asia. Now the color blue indicates North Asia, which primarily includes Russia. Russia is the biggest country in the world. Now, on the map, the yellow region indicates East Asia, which includes China, Korea, both North Korea and South Korea, and Japan. The Southeast Asia, which is orange in color, includes Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, Philippines, Brunei, Indonesia, Singapore, and East Timor. Now, the countries which are shown pink in color in this map are forming the region called as Central Asia. And these are Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan. The countries which are green in color are West Asia, and these include Armenia, Azerbaijan, Bahrain, Cyprus, Georgia, Iran, Iraq, Israel, Jordan, Kuwait, Lebanon, Oman, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Syria, Turkey, United Arab Emirates and Yemen. Now, this distinction between regions help us to understand the complexity in greater detail. But despite all these differences, there are some similarities between all these regions in Asia as well. But in this chapter, we'll focus only on the region called as South Asia. South Asia, which is different from Southeast Asia. Southeast Asia, like South Asia, is a sub-region of Asia or Asian continent in which we have other countries. South Asia or Southeast Asia consists of countries that are located geographically to south of China, east of India, and west of New Guinea and north of Australia. Now, this is South Asia. Look at this map. This shows all the countries which are part of South Asian region. This includes India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan, Maldives, and Afghanistan. Now, South Asia consists of sub-Himalayan countries. These countries we have just listed are Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Afghanistan. South Asia has a distinctive geographical identity. We have mighty Himalayan mountain range in the north, and there are three water bodies in the south of South Asian region. These are Bay of Bengal, Indian Ocean, and the Arabian Sea on the three sides of the region. These geographical features provide a natural boundary to the South Asian region. The boundaries between north and south are more clear-cut in South Asian region as compared to boundaries in the east and west, because on north you have Himalaya and on south you have Indian Ocean. However, east and west can go further beyond the perceived boundaries of South Asia. And that is why at times Myanmar is also included in South Asian region when other people define it as South Asian. And also Afghanistan lately became part of South Asia by taking over membership of SAARC. Now, like any other continent, South Asia has a variety of geographical features. There are glaciers, valleys, deserts, rainforest, grasslands, plateau, rivers, backwaters, and a wide variety of climatic zones which have sub-zero temperature in some areas or which have the highest recorded temperature on planet Earth. Some of the areas in South Asia receive maximum rainfall, and some of the areas are the most dry areas on the Earth. South Asia is ethnically very diverse also. We have over 2,000 ethnic entities existing in South Asia. The population of all these ethnic entities can range from few hundred people to millions of people. They exist either as main cultural groups or very small tribes that are cut off from the rest of the world. But despite this diversity, there is some socio-cultural distinctiveness about this region in the subcontinent, which is called as South Asia. South Asia is a very typical geopolitical space, and it exhibits a typical set of dynamics between the countries that constitute this region. China is not part of South Asian subcontinent. Yet, China is an important player or factor influencing the politics in the region. China is influencing much of the politics and strategic dimensions of the nations in the subcontinent and their relationship with one another. We'll discuss how China is doing this in our subsequent discussions. But since in the previous chapter in this book, we have discussed about the European Union and the ASEAN as examples of regional organizations, now let us discuss about SAARC, the regional organization of the South Asian countries. What is the full form of SAARC? The SAARC is the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. It was established in December 1985 by Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. Why was SAARC formed or it was established? SAARC was established to provide a platform for the people of South Asia to work together to accelerate the process of economic and social development among the member states of the SAARC. Afghanistan joined SAARC as its 8th member state in the month of April in 2007, after 22 years of its establishment. The idea of regional, political and economic cooperation in South Asia was first raised in 1980s by Ziaur Rahman, the president of Bangladesh, who proposed the idea of a trade bloc that could comprise of only South Asian countries. This idea was well accepted by India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Bhutan. So what were the reasons for formation of SAARC? What was the logic behind establishment of this regional bloc? The first important reason was that South Asia somehow is very strategically and centrally located in Asian region. The other important point was all the countries which were part of South Asia gained independence after Second World War. And as a result of British colonialism, because they were under British colonial rule, all countries have the same cultural background and history. Most of them share it. In fact, Pakistan, India and Bangladesh were the same country before partition in 1947 and independence of India and other countries. This region was relatively poor and was having a large population. And the main economic activity was agriculture. So in 1983, there was a summit in New Delhi, whereby the declaration regarding the formation of South Asian Regional Cooperation was adopted. Later, three other countries, Nepal, Bhutan and Maldives, joined in. There were mainly five areas in which these seven countries decided to cooperate. That is, seven countries deciding to come together to cooperate with each other in five important areas. What were these areas? The first area was human resource development. The second area was the area of transport, linking each other with rail and road. The third important area was health and population activities. The fourth area was telecommunications, science, meteorology and technology. And the fifth important area was agriculture and rural development. Now, what were the core objectives of SAARC? What did they want to achieve by forming this regional organization? Let us run through these objectives quickly. The core objectives of SAARC were, the first was to promote and strengthen collective self-reliance among the countries of South Asia. That is, they would rely on each other and promote coordination among themselves. The second important objective was to contribute to develop mutual trust and understanding and appreciate one another and help them solving their problems. The third important objective was to promote active collaboration and mutual assistance in the economic, social, cultural, technical and scientific fields. Yet another important objective was to strengthen cooperation with other developing countries. That is, together they'll form a bloc and communicate or interact with other developing countries. Then there was a need to strengthen cooperation among themselves in international forums on matters of common interest. Say if they are representing themselves in UN, can they represent themselves together as South Asia, or do they go as individual countries and have less power or collectively have more power in other regional organizations? Then there was a need to cooperate with international and other regional organizations which had similar aim and purpose. So these were some of the objectives that SAARC wanted to achieve. While interacting with one another, SAARC countries also follow some fundamental principles. What are these principles? Now, let us discuss these one by one. Now, SAARC countries cooperate with each other both bilaterally and multilaterally. They tend to address or respect the sovereign equality among the member states. There is a principle which cherishes territorial integrity of all these individual member states. They acknowledge each other's political independence, and there is also an agreement that there will be non-interference in the internal affairs of the other states and mutual benefits. These are the principles that form the basic framework of interaction between these SAARC countries. SAARC members have signed the South Asian Free Trade Agreement also, which is also called as SAFTA, which promised the formation of a free trade zone for the whole of South Asia. Now, SAFTA, the free trade agreement or the zone, was thought of, envisaged primarily as the first step towards the transition to a free trade zone, leading towards formation of a customs union, common market and economic union gradually, stage by stage. The 10th SAARC summit, which happened in Colombo in July 1998, decided to set up a committee of experts. What would this committee do? They will draft a treaty framework for creating a free trade area within the region. And what they were supposed to do they were supposed to take into account the asymmetries or differences in the development within the region and then identify or fix realistic and achievable targets. The SAFTA agreement was signed on 6th January 2004 during the 12th SAARC summit that was held in Islamabad in Pakistan. The agreement entered into force on 1st of January 2006 and the Trade Liberalization Program TLP started from 1st July 2006. The exports under SAFTA plan free trade agreement have been witnessing a positive and upward trend since the launching of Trade Liberalization Program. The idea behind SAFTA is that a new era of relationship of peace and cooperation will emerge if South Asian countries allow free trade across the borders. And the countries which are dependent upon each other, or there is economic interdependence, or there is a trade between them, they tend to fight less with each other. There are minimum conflicts between countries which are trading with one another. Briefly stating then, the primary aim of SAARC was to improve quality of life and welfare of people in these countries, to accelerate economic growth, social progress and cultural development. The aim was to contribute towards the mutual trust building and strengthening cooperation between member states and also coordinate with other developing countries. But unfortunately, SAARC has not been a very successful organization. In the previous chapter, we discussed about the European Union and ASEAN as two important regional organization or regional blocs. But SAARC has not been able to match even the half mark of the success achieved by the European Union. The idea to establish SAARC was conceived so that the countries of South Asia could grow and prosper together through mutual association and cooperation. It was thought that the association will bring benefit to the entire region. But political rivalries between countries in the region went against the imagined ideal or the dream of progressing together. Mutual suspicion and mistrust regarding each other among the member states has made many of the worth ideas a failure in SAARC. Like the aim of SAFTA was to lower the trade tariffs between member states so as to improve business between these nations. India thinks that increase in trade will bring real economic benefits to all the states, and that a region that trades more freely and is economically interconnected will be able to cooperate better on political issues. But some of the neighboring states feared or suspected that SAFTA is a way for India to invade their market. They thought that India intends to influence their society and politics through its presence and by establishing commercial ventures. And being wary or tired of such allegations or fears on the part of other groups, those who think India has a bad intention, SAFTA, India thinks, is not worth the trouble, taking as much as the suspicion comes to India. So, India has already signed bilateral agreements with Bhutan, Nepal and Sri Lanka. So, India is not taking much of the interest in SAFTA. Now, within the background of this mistrust and mutual suspicion, and given the nature of the strained or tense relationship between India and its neighbors and other South Asian countries, and among them, SAARC has been reduced to merely a platform where annual talks and meetings are held without yielding anything much. Now, let us think or ponder over the question why SAARC has not been successful. Is it something related to history and the nature of relationship between various South Asian countries, or is it something else? It is important to discuss history of each country, which is part of South Asia, briefly, their demography, their culture, their society, and their experiment with or their journey to establish democracy, their internal situation and their relationship with India, in order to know the entire dynamics or matrix of relationships existing between nations in South Asia. But that we'll do in the subsequent parts of this chapter. To conclude this part, let's summarize what we discussed today. In this part of the chapter, we discussed about the SAARC. We discussed the formation of SAARC, What are the objectives of SAARC? What are the fundamental principles that SAARC as a regional organization follows? We also discuss the areas where member states and SAARC cooperate with each other. And we also raise a question that why SAARC has been a failure as compared to other successful regional organizations. We'll be discussing these issues to find out what are the reasons behind the mistrust, mutual suspicion or strained relationship between countries in the South Asia. In the next part of this chapter, we'll discuss about the relationship between India and Bhutan and between India and Nepal. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.